You are listening to a Romecast with Neil Kramer.
The spice must flow.
We don't want to scare anybody.
The next stop is Delancey Street, Essex Street.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.
To roam, to wander, to go from place to place, as Merriam-Webster dictionary tells us, without purpose or direction. Which, to the uninitiated, seems rather a pointless exercise. Yet in exploring purposelessness, one approaches purpose. Sounds paradoxical, but I found that to be a very important exercise in my life. And it's a technique I often share with people I work with to suggest that they free up a day, go out into the world without an agenda, without schedule, with no clear purpose whatsoever. Just an inclination to explore and to see what transpires. And for that reason, the word roam seems rather appropriate. And I notice also that the secondary definition, to travel purposefully, unhindered through a wide area. Oxymoron definition. Two opposing definitions for the same thing, like quite. It was quite large. Oh, it was quite large. Meaning a little or a lot. Something and nothing. Meaning and meaningless. And also, with it being the 21st century, I noticed that the third definition of roam is to use a cellular phone outside one's local calling area. So these are really spoken word essays of a sort, an opportunity to say some of the things I would have said previously in written format, on the page, out loud, with the voice, spontaneously. So whilst I have some idea of roughly what I want to cover and essentially what I want to explore or achieve, how that eventually becomes articulated is beyond my knowing, something that I don't have any awareness of, and I find that quite interesting. Not only that, but to embed that spoken word into the movement of the environment, into public places, into outdoor spaces and train stations and cars, and moving through the environment, encountering seemingly random incoming vectors, new experiences and sights, and dogs barking and people asking questions and smiling and shouting and all the hubbub of normal human nature. So to put the word into that space gives it some sort of reality that is not present on the page. And whilst the page certainly has its own artistry, and those who enjoy language and sentence construction and choice of words and so on can appreciate that that is best done on the page, what we're really doing here is not being writers or readers. We're not enjoying literature as such. We're using language to express something, to explore wisdom and transcendence and metaphysics and philosophy and life, culture, people, growth, all those things. And it might therefore be interesting, having put out a large number of essays over the years, to do this differently. Checking in with shadow. Doing things in this way gives me an opportunity to address some of the more topical matters of the day, current affairs and so on, and particularly things I would like to go into in a little more detail, things that I'm not always able to explore deeply during a regular interview situation, for obvious reasons. And also, I can just talk about other things, subjects that might be a bit obscure or irreverent even, or certainly hold some sort of singular, fascinating aspect. But for the moment, I have been reminded in recent times, largely because of events in December 2012, that shadow is something that is constantly demanding our attention, and usually deservingly so, in my view. And that is not necessarily the evils of the world or the negativities of the world that are just unpleasant, but the difficult to look at areas of the world, the demons of the world that we ourselves have created in some manner, that we can only resolve, own, integrate, whatever you want to call it, by addressing them and understanding them and rewiring them, essentially. Now, as many of you will know, there was this shooting, the Sandy Hook shooting, that took place in December in 2012. Now, on the back of that, there were some shocking proposals put forth by the Obama administration, immediately jumping on that in the most grotesque and cheesy, tacky, horrid manner to exploit that situation for political purposes too quickly, far too quickly and too grossly. And in discussing these matters in an interview, which I'll come to in a minute, it became very obvious to me that some people were very uncomfortable with the idea that I could possibly be pro-gun and anti-government. Surprising, to put it mildly. And it made me realise that there was something odd going on, which was that a lot of people were still characterising various spiritual and philosophical and metaphysical thinkers as left-leaning, you might even say, hippie-ish. And that view is, I think, is odd, very sort of 1960s view. Because frankly, anybody who's interested in the kind of work that I do, my version of it and other people's version of it, it's absolutely about self-reliance, self-determination and fierce independence. Not being part of society as such, not being part of government, not recognising that relationship at all. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't support your community and your friends and your family, and you uphold civil conduct, you observe common sense human laws, you don't go around like some kind of loony. You observe what is there in front of you. You take note of what is real, and you aim for better all the time. I'm very much into self-reliance and very much into small government. I don't believe that the government has any responsibility to support its citizens in a habit-forming manner, which is what I see happening in America in the last 3 years that I've lived here. I think that's stupid. And whilst it's always obviously clear that any sensible government would help citizens who need help, and any community would help each other, that shouldn't be mandated to such a ridiculous level where millions of people depend on their day-to-day survival for that, and it becomes year after year after year way of being. That's crazy. This whole thing started from an interview that I did recently, right at the end of 2012, with my friend and colleague, Mr. Brooks Agnew, or to give him his proper title, Dr. Brooks Agnew. And I first met Brooks in the summer of 2011 at a conference at the Isetti Ranch up in Trout Lake in Washington State, which is essentially the sort of home of James Gilliland and his crew up there, who are interested in paranormal and phenomena things, but more than anything have created a venue for spiritual, metaphysical and philosophical discussion, and people gather there for all different kinds of reasons throughout the year. And it's a great place, great people doing some amazing work, all with different ideas, don't agree with some of them, heartily agree with many other things those guys are doing. And it's just a great place. There are others like that, but up here where I live, that's one of the chief focal points for such things. And it's just over the Columbia River from the neighbouring state of Oregon where I live. So Brooks and I had both been invited as speakers, and since that time I've seen him a couple of other times, and his wonderful companion Robin too, a lovely woman. And we've had some great discussions, found some real parallels in our thinking, which is odd, because if you look at the pair of us, we don't look like we should agree with each other. But there are some very good resonances, and I think we saw that in each other. And it's interesting to get very, very different perspectives on that. and see what we can learn about ourselves, each other, and what other people might feel about these issues. So, you know, there was a good dynamic there. And so Brooks had me on his show recently, X Squared Radio, for the second time actually. And we talked about the preservation of the Second Amendment, the Constitution, and this deceitful image and corrupt philosophy of the current administration, of which the figurehead is Obama. And we had a great conversation for 3 hours, really in-depth, good stuff. And you can grab those MP3s at neilkramer.com, they're all linked up from there. And we both had some great feedback, and the listeners really seemed to appreciate our very forthright and sincere exposition of the main issues as we saw them. Definitely not the party line on gun control, not the message that Obama would like us to parrot, or the corporate media, not by a long chalk. So, as often happens, I received a ton of appreciative, supportive, and positive emails. We did a great show. Lots of great juice on that one. Thank you. Wonderful. Excellent interview. Okay, let's move on. Move on to the next thing. But no. Why? Because for some people, the idea of Neil Kramer supporting the choice to bear arms and being anti-government did not sit well at all. The thing is, when you spend a lot of your time talking about consciousness and mysticism and spiritual growth and this ancient wisdom and whatnot, you know, you can happily discuss these things with people until the cows come home. The nature of reality, how many dimensions there are, the mystical origins of world religions, the importance of emotional intelligence, the reality of the fourth density, all these amazing things, all kinds of fascinating stuff. People can agree, disagree, stroke the chin in puzzlement, frown, applaud, smile, or whatever. No problem. No problem. And the vast majority of people, whether in accordance or not, will speak in an informed and respectful manner, whatever their views. But once again, on the issue of the Second Amendment, no. It was different. What a strange state of affairs. Doesn't often happen in my interactions, this kind of thing. So it was just a curious episode for me, just to think, wow, that's really got people riled up. And Americans might wisely say, well, listen, Kramer, you start talking about guns and abortion and race and things like that, and you're going to run into all kinds of problems. You go down south and start talking about Christianity and religion in any kind of challenging way, and you're going to get lynched, sonny boy. And in the corporate media mirage of society, I would agree with that and say, well, yeah, I can see that. But in the communities that I usually speak to, both face-to-face and, of course, electronically through the internet and through radio and podcasts and whatnot, you expect more than that. You expect a broader, deeper view than that. So that was the surprise, that that wasn't the case. They even, amid some of the people who have been following my work for a long time, they were shocked to see me slag off Obama and all the sort of goblins that follow him around. As I might say a few times in this little diatribe, it's not about politics, not about being a damned Republican or a damned Democrat. It's irrelevant, all that stuff, quite frankly. I am against Obama, but I was against Tony Blair, Alistair Campbell, Peter Mandelson, George Bush, Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, Colin Powell, Condi Rice, David Cameron, George Osborne, Theresa May, and all those other people, all those other government people. They move against sovereignty. They move against informed consent. And they do not display authentic, honourable will. So I reject them. I reject their words because they are not founded in reality. And so it just seems odd to me that people could get so very belligerent about this issue of guns and modern democratic party politics in America today, as if that's somehow all removed from our usual philosophical discourse. It's not. It's part of it. In fact, one might say it's right at the heart of it, but because it lies in shadow, some people can't see it clearly. Some people imagine it to be something else. And this leads me to the lesson, for me at least, that I found in this little debacle, which is this. People are still popping the blue pill on a much larger scale,
than I had supposed. Now that might just be my own naivety, but if I can underestimate that, then probably some other people can too. Now, just in case you don't know what I mean by the blue pill, this is a reference to the 1999 film The Matrix, and in the movie, in this science fiction film, the character Morpheus offers the character Neo / Thomas Anderson the choice of either taking the blue pill, which would keep him in this false world of the Matrix, or the red pill, which would lead to his escape from the illusion and his liberation into the real world. So this little bit of terminology represents a handy shortcut for describing people who choose the impure path of a contrived counterfeit reality, or the pure path of the astonishing authentic world. Most people who are interested in consciousness and self-development and spiritual truth and real experiences of real life would naturally state that they have chosen the red pill. But that isn't always the case. Secretly, in the background, quietly, they're still popping the blue pills. There is a serious diving off the cliff into the unknown for anyone who genuinely takes the red pill and chooses the real organic world over the distorted construct beamed into people's heads by the old hierarchy. Big questions about government, physics, society, law, psychology, the military-industrial complex, mystical knowledge, schemes to keep men dim-witted, bizarre covert think tanks that prescribe global cultural trends, the puppet show of politics, the psychic faculties of the human mind, big philosophical questions about birth, death, and purpose. The entire reflection of what is here in our world, why, and what is our place in it. That's the diving off the cliff of the red pill. Do you want to not only approach that stuff, but embrace it and make it part of your lived daily life? And unless all of these things have been deeply contemplated, unless they have been ruminated over, experienced, grappled with, dreamt of, desired, and determined, then that human mind that has not taken it upon itself to do those things is absolutely caught in the net of a fake world. That is the default position for those who choose not to grasp the nettle of reality. They drift in a simulation. They live not in a world, but in a mental construct that is a miserable imitation of the real thing. The real thing is big, magnificent, and frighteningly wonderful. But to get to it, to make meaningful contact with it, you have to let go of the fake world. And most people are not willing, prepared, or able to do that. They play around with it, sure. They pretend to let go, but they are actually still holding firmly onto it. Whilst there is a single piece of faulty thinking about any foundational concepts of government, society, culture, politics, whatever, all those things, whilst there is a single element of investment in those illusions, then the mind is lost. Every thought and perception is compromised as soon as it arises. No discussion with such minds is worthwhile. Those who choose illusion cannot, by definition, perceive the real world or any of the dynamics and components that constitute it. And naturally, those who choose illusion are not always aware that they have done so. You know, in their deepest, most truthful inner core, they are conscious of it. But that is buried deep. In normal conversation and thinking, it is not referenced. It's not relevant. This selection of the illusion does not exist. They aren't doing anything. They're just living in the world like everyone else. What's the problem? What are you talking about? Here I am. I'm doing stuff in the world. What illusion? Crazy man. If you don't think freely and truly for yourself, if you don't claim your power and sovereignty to determine for yourself what the real world is, then you consent to live in a forgery. And in that forgery, which as I say is a mental construct an unreality signal. Any discussion of guns is a waste of time. Any discussion of politics is meaningless. Any discussion of any substantial subject is dishonest and hollow. So, this is a divisive thing, is it not? But that doesn't necessarily mean, even when we do observe these things and do detect these minds that are not free, that are consenting to deceit, there's still no judgment involved. There's no value judgment required, not at all. Everyone is on a sacred journey, learning about themselves, the universe, and the relationship between the two. If they choose to do that very slowly, and in fact keep postponing and abandoning this project to hide instead in the coarse materiality of the third density Earth realm, then that's fine, no problem. Go for it. From a higher level of no self, and no qualitative difference between what we might call one human soul and another, there is no crime here. There's nothing wrong. We're just observing people caught up in the net. It's frustrating when those people have a bullhorn, have a mouthpiece, have a platform for being very vociferous and indignant. It's very frustrating to see that when, God help us, our instinct is shut the fuck up. It's frustrating, hard to deny that. But there's still nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with that choice. And I've often said that the worst thing that a human can do is to drift. To just drift into whatever comes along, good or bad, pleasing or rancid, blissful or painful. And that is what happens to people who disavow their will and the gift of their unique experience as a sovereign spirit on this planet. They forfeit their right to self-determination. They bob around in the river, floating around like a little twig, sometimes this way, sometimes that way, hitting rocks, sometimes plain sailing, sometimes being smashed and torn apart. This is living without exercising the will. This is how it looks when people do not take responsibility for their own consciousness. So considering that with these people, can we expect a good answer to this question? Is it a good idea to make sure that good, honourable men and women are able to bear arms to protect against oppressive and tyrannical government? Can illusion-dwelling minds feasibly provide any sort of intelligent answer to this, when they have already indicated their unwillingness to take ownership of their own conscious experience of reality? I know in my bones that those people cannot sensibly answer important questions because they're not in a position to. You see, I told you this was checking in with Shadow, didn't I? About 8 years ago, I began writing for my blog, The Cleaver, because I wanted to create a clear and truthful platform in the best way that I knew how to combat the disgraceful lies of the UK government, which were reaching a crescendo of crookedness around 2005, 2006. And this was during the Tony Blair government, the Labour Party, from 1997 to 2007, they held power. The Labour Party is the equivalent in the US of the Democratic Party. Also, around that time, I noticed that a lot of naive people were finally roused into some semblance of awareness when they saw Tony Blair reverently supporting the imperial right-wing administration of George W. Bush. Very blatantly, between the whole period between 2001 to 2005. During that time, a number of very prominent political cartoonists in England habitually drew Tony Blair with blood dripping from his hands. And this was in cartoons directly commentating on the fake war on terror and the deceptive Iraq business, but also in domestic political situations that had nothing to do with the war, Blair was still shown with these red stained hands. And even these guys were sending previously ignorant left-wing voters the message that their leader was a dishonourable man and was not left-wing, and in fact the whole paradigm of left wing and right wing, of socialism and capitalism, was coming to an end. There were not two opposing sides anymore.
There are some people who talk and some people who don't, which means that there are some people who leave this place and some who do not leave. You are obviously staying.
Has it ever occurred to you that you're just as much a prisoner as I am?
Oh, my dear chap, of course, I know too much. We're both lifers. I am definitely an optimist. That's why it doesn't matter who number one is. It doesn't matter which side runs the village.
It's run by one side or the other.
Oh, certainly. But both sides are becoming identical. What, in fact, has been created? An international community. A perfect blueprint for world order. When the sides facing each other suddenly realize that they're looking into a mirror, they will see that this is the pattern for the future.
The whole earth as the village. Yes.
That is my hope. What's yours?
I'd like to be the first man on the moon.
Well, must go. Delightful chat. Thank you, number six.
And some of these cartoonists worked for left-leaning newspapers like The Guardian, which is a good quality newspaper, still is. In some ways, they were channeling the disillusionment of millions of Britons for the total abandonment of Labour Party principles. And this venal cabal of Alistair Campbell, Peter Mandelson and Tony Blair, these individuals totally crushed the last vestiges of the uncodified British Constitution and effectively did away with anybody's written rights for anything at all. Freedom of speech, right to process, radically reduced and continue to shrink, and the flabby interpretation of what it means to plot terrorism, where any sort of subversive thoughts and deeds could be punished without any obstacle of law. People were and continue to be just lifted off the streets. Not just funny brown people with funny clothes that don't look like lovely white English people, but anyone. Red, white, brown, green, purple, English, Arabic, Muslim, Christian, anybody, anybody involved, anyone who's subversive enough was lifted, taken away. Bye-bye. So in the thick of this, I noticed that the government were determined to remove weapons from the population as fast as possible. Now, England had already been essentially disarmed, which we'll come to in a moment, but they were targeting knives and any potentially offensive weapon. Any sort of knife violence was pulled right to the top of the national news every single night. If the government had the people's best interests at heart, taking weapons out of circulation might represent, you know, explicable and very prudent thinking, of course. But when you realise that the government couldn't care less about the people, you realise, as is codified into the US Constitution, that guns are also to protect people against government. But polite British people don't like to talk about such things. It's all very upsetting and demoralising, that kind of thing. Not to brilliant, awesome, conscious British people who know better, but to mainstream dumbasses. They would rather not think about such things and hold this image that Britain is peaceful and wonderful and progressive. So that's why I started the cleaver, to go into all this lot and say, hang on a second, there's something very, very wrong here, and nobody's talking about this in the way that I would like to hear about it, so rather than just sit on my arse and moan, let me try and do something about it with my little tiny voice. Let me try and say things. Let me try and make that voice a little bit bigger. So one way of doing that was to sort of remind people just how quickly guns get removed from the map of social consciousness. And there's some bits here from my essay of June 2006, Disarming the People. In Britain, it began with the Pistols Act of 1903. And this seemingly rational law established that handgun sales could only be made to those who had a license. Now again, in a sane and moral society governed with integrity by men and women of honour, this would be cool, right? Of course it would. It would be common sense. But unfortunately, we're a long way from that. And so in the meantime, it is wise to keep weapons so people who do have honour, who do embody honour in their daily life, and balance, and civility, and wisdom, the good guys, in other words, right, they can make sure that things don't go totally sour. And corrupt government know this, and so they make every attempt to remove weapons from the hands of the general public. They pretend to care about the people, they pretend to be aiming for peace, when in reality they're doing nothing of the sort, nothing of the sort. So, you know, it's all very unpleasant, this, isn't it? Just to make matters worse, such governments will willfully organise psychological operations, psyops. Apparently, terrible spontaneous acts of violence that outrage the unthinking common man and spark him into doing something rash or agreeing to something rash. And these fake happenings, these psyops or false flag events, have been an instrument of statecraft for every major world power for thousands of years. Make no mistake about that. And I talk about this in my book, The Unfoldment. There's a chapter that goes into this, just for those who aren't aware of it. And so do many other authors, of course, particularly over the last 30 years or so. And if you doubt this stuff and consider it to be just some crackpot conspiracy nonsense, just stop listening now and go and watch CNN and BBC and see if that makes you feel better. So, you know, a really clever device for corrupt governments to start the ball rolling on disarmament was to establish registration. Right? Seems okay on the surface, but can very easily be used to track, identify, and withdraw ownership at a moment's notice. So the Firearms Act of 1920 expanded this to include not only handguns, but all firearms except shotguns. Later laws, passed in 1953 and 1967, outlawed the carrying of any weapon by private citizens and mandated the registration of all shotguns. So by the 70s, no one really ever saw weapons in England. Few little gun clubs had them, people who were really interested and enjoyed shooting and target practice and all the rest of it. It's not in people's consciousness. Anyone under the age of 40 really isn't aware of guns in England. They don't understand it. They don't see that in the public conversation. The real acceleration of disarmament began with two figures, two people, Michael Ryan and Thomas Hamilton. In 1987, Michael Ryan, this guy, apparently walked through the English countryside and shot 16 people. And this led to the Firearms Amendment Act 1988, which banned the ownership of semi-automatic rifles and restricted the use of other firearms with a capacity of more than two rounds. And this is the kind of thing that is going on right now at the time of this recording in the States. They are associating mass killings with semi-automatic weapons. Back in England, 9 years after that event, in 1996, another guy, Thomas Hamilton, killed 15 schoolchildren and a teacher after walking into a school and opening fire. Shortly after, the UK government instigated a UK-wide ban on handguns. All gone. So after these two incidents, pistols, revolvers, rifles, pump-action shotguns, and practically every other form of firearm you can imagine disappeared off the radar completely. And although the Tory legislation banned only handguns greater than 2.2 calibre, which was bad enough, the new Labour government went further with the Firearms Amendment No. 2 Act 1997 and effectively banned all handguns. Now after this Thomas Hamilton thing, they had this Dunblane inquiry, which is a shocking whitewash. Awful and very plainly deceptive. And when that Dunblane inquiry ended, the few law-abiding citizens left who owned handguns legally were given 3 months to turn them over to local authorities. Anyone who disobeyed was visited by police and threatened with a 10-year prison sentence if they didn't comply. And as I say in the essay, Hungerford was a well-controlled situation. Awareness of government duplicity was astonishingly low back in 1987. Dunblane, however, 9 years later, left a lot of loose ends. Numerous theories arose focusing on relationships between the Central Scotland Police, secret societies, George Robertson, MI6, supporters of the Snowdrop Petition and Northern Ireland terrorist organisations. Of course, nothing could be proven or substantiated. Public outrage, dead women and children, and 90 years of accelerating gun control made radical policy change easy. It was soon virtually impossible to own a handgun. Shooting clubs went out of business overnight. Some even switched to air rifles and muzzle-loading muskets in an effort to lawfully diversify and still offer something to law-abiding punters who enjoyed shooting. Even Olympic marksmen still have to leave the UK to practice and compete properly. So you get the picture of that. From an enlightened, awakened position, from a position of truth, that's a problem. Because you can't trust the government to be the only people who have the guns. Simple as that. Let us not allow that to happen in America. It must not. The government cannot be trusted. The people bear arms specifically to ensure the security of a free state, i.e. to defend against tyrannical government. My gut tells me that Sandy Hook was another in a long line of these psyops. And if you do a careful analysis of the incident, compare all the local and national media broadcasts, listen to witness reports, use your own discerning powers of critical reason, the whole event fits perfectly the profile of a psyop. Confirmed multiple shooters, prepackaged nutty lone shooter narrative, tightly controlled media reporting, fake interviews, logistical improbabilities, the immediate labelling of serious questioning of events as disgraceful conspiracy. And you might want to check out the work of a guy called James F. Tracy, who has written about this quite sensibly in my view. Not perfect on everything, but brave, courageous. I'm not going to go into the whole thing here, it's not the time or place for it. And maybe I won't anywhere else for that matter, but I've done my own study on this and it's pretty obvious that the official story is a fairy tale. And I think that if you do the homework yourself and go into it, which is probably about 10 days dedicated study, all day, every day, so pack that all together or do it the best way you can with your schedule. If you do that, I promise you that you will come away realizing that Sandy Hook was not the result of Adam Lanza going bonkers. For me, the equation is pretty simple. Gun control equals disarmament. If anybody thinks that it is a good idea to disarm oneself right now, where we are, not where we think we are or where we'd like to be, but right now where we actually are, if anyone thinks it's a good idea to do that with just good intentions and hope, then I see a very long journey ahead for that person. I see that they are at the very smallest foothills of Mount Everest and have a mind-boggling ascent to make before any perceptions of truth are achieved. This whole thing about guns has raised a very important dynamic for me. And it could have been any issue, any discussion, any dialogue really, but it happened to be a constitutional matter, the Second Amendment bit to do with arms. Now, the unreality signal forbids a number of topics for discussion. You cannot seriously, in the corporate media, discuss the education system, deleterious religious doctrine, ethnicity, immigration, abortion, the Second Amendment, unconstitutional government practices, the myth of American innocence, and last but not least, you cannot seriously discuss state-sponsored terrorism. You're not allowed. Fake conversations are conducted with people like Piers Morgan, and occasionally excellent people will get onto that program and do something honourable and meaningful. But by and large, it's all a big massive waste of time, and all the CNN and MSNBC stuff, all just shockingly bad. And no one escapes that, neither The Guardian, nor Fox, nor the BBC, nor anybody, right, left, or in the middle, doesn't matter, nobody escapes that. We all know this is going on. And we all know what the media is full of, but how ironic, you know, who gives a shit about the Golden Globes or some obnoxious director's rubbish new film or a new model of smartphone? Who is dating who in the celebrity world, you know? What sports teams are doing? What new cars are at the big convention this year and some rapper arrested for violence or a rock star arrested for drug abuse? You know, shock horror, an actor caught in a toilet with his pants down. Who cares about that? What is the significance of these news items compared to the enormous crimes against the Constitution that are being thrust into the lives of the American people currently by the Obama administration? You know, when you speak publicly, or not even publicly, just openly about these things, whether it's to one other person or thousands or millions of other people, people get upset when you say things that don't fit with the image they had projected onto you. Which is weird, because most people who listen to me and read my words and realise that there are no wrong answers, because there are no belief systems to uphold, no doctrines to maintain, no laws to enforce. Everything is up for grabs, ready for deconstructing, no rules. Everything is acceptable for honest philosophical analysis, right? And yet, there still seems to persist this type of individual who's developed like a peculiar skill of listening only to the bits that fit their belief systems and ignoring the rest. Now, we all do that a little bit. You'll look at 100 things and choose the 57 from that list that fit your view and maybe ignore the rest. And as you go through life, you realise that isn't the best way to do it. You should consider all of them and truthfully bring them in. And if that means you have to adapt to your view or your belief or your model of thinking, then do it. Go with what is true. And your discernment of truth is based on your spiritual attainment, in my view. So you do the best you can. But for others, it becomes a chronic habit to only take the positives that fit with their view and throw out the rest. It's a very common error, but for a certain sort of person, let us call them a spiritual idealist, it is a fatal mistake. So bizarre. They're projecting falsehood onto things that challenge them. I am completely prepared to receive new ideas and challenges to my statements, lateral, critical alternatives to whatever I say, whatever, whenever. And as my close friends know, I am very quick to go, you know what, I was totally wrong on that. Oh my God, how embarrassing. Never mind, because now I know, and it's time to move on. And nobody's really giving a shit about that except yourself. So the quicker we learn to think, God, I thought that for ages and it's complete horseshit, the quicker you get over that little weird rumble in your psyche and just think, oh well, whatever, now I know, I think I'm a wiser person now, the quicker you can build that into your learning apparatus, the better. The disease of the spiritual idealist, which is sort of characterised by New Agey people a little bit, if you know what I mean. The disease of that way of doing things is that they bring in only a certain sort of energy at the expense of other energy. They focus only on the light and turn their back on darkness by inventing childish and wholly unrealistic escapist fantasies. You know, holding hands under the big rainbow bridge across the world, laying down arms, trusting the government to do a splendid job, and generally just substituting insight for hope, which is always exceedingly unwise. I can't remember word for word, but Krishnamurti once said something along the lines of, forget hope, it's a pile of shit. As I say, I don't think that's quite how he put it, but he made that point very strongly. Nobody's bothered when you fall down except you. And if somebody sees that you get things wrong, correct it and move on all the time, they very quickly cease to be interested when you make another error. Now, if you base your whole life on one argument, that's a problem. But if you base your life on truth, then making mistakes becomes a part of your daily practice. A mistake is that you had said, look, this is the shape of this thing, okay? And then as you learn more, you realise that it actually isn't. But it was the best that you knew at the time, but the shape is actually different to what you thought it was. Well, I thought it was that, but it's actually, to the best of my knowledge right now, this shape. And that shape continues to evolve. So it's extremely odd to pin your colours to just one shape and say, that is it, that's the shape, I'm not moving, I don't care what happens, that is the shape that I use to define myself. Very odd to do that, and very odd to do that for other people as well, to say that is what he is, that is what she is, that is what this musician is to me, that is what this painter is to me, and how dare they change their shape, how dare they change their character, because I had that very clearly and nicely defined, and now they've messed it up. And that's what the spiritual idealist does. They project those images, those shapes, inaccurately, incorrectly, dishonourably onto other people. The spiritual idealist is afraid of reality because they know that they are impotent to make meaningful changes. So instead, they dream. Falsehood within falsehood, a dream within a dream. And anyone who breaks that dream, they attack. Because they're spoiling the ideal. They're spoiling it with dirty, gritty, cumbersome hardness of reality. It is as if the entire idea of the control system, thousands of years of imperial conquest, the existence of terribly disturbed minds, and the whole endeavour of free-thinking, conscious, authentic men and women trying to live their own lives however they want, is all suddenly, somehow, adjourned because of the fantasy of a society with no guns, presided over by a kind-hearted administration led by lovely Mr. Barack Obama, trying to do the very best that they can for people in very difficult circumstances. What a degrading thing to do. To disregard the whole campaign for spiritual truth, the whole gift of sovereign power, of human dignity, for the one-size-fits-all delusion of a caring government and a healthy society. What a bizarre choice for consciousness. What an odd thing to do. Disgraceful it is, I think. Not unforgivable, you know, no kidding. But you first have to admit it to yourself and say, ah, okay, maybe I need to take another look at that. Maybe I do. Well, as you have probably heard during this recording, it is raining. But that rain is passing by and the sun is starting to shine. And maybe that means that now I can leap forth from this vehicle and actually get out into nature. And let us see how that changes this discourse. A change of tone now. I can now see the sun on the Pacific Ocean, and this is a beautiful place, and there are forested pyramids to my left, to my right, this enormous Pacific Ocean. It's a lovely winter January day. It's about 50 degrees Fahrenheit, so it's just kind of perfect, really. And in this place, it reminds me of there's a bit in the Lord of the Rings text where Gandalf utters the language of Mordor in Rivendell. And it feels a bit like that, talking about this gun issue here. Kind of is dissonant, and it feels like maybe I shouldn't be doing it. But fuck that. Sometimes you need to utter the language of Mordor. I'm just going to finish off on this, and then we'll talk about something else. But it's so important. I see this as just one huge issue of freedom and liberty. And this is one small part of it. It's not the big thing. But it's one little thing that composes the big thing. And right now, our attention on it is required, in my view. And you know, why I bothered to look into all this, why I chose to direct my focus away from matters of conscious unfoldment and philosophical contemplation, and instead turn them to the shadowy puke of politics. Why did I do this? I'll tell you, there was one defining moment for me. When Obama seemed to tear up on television when commenting on the Sandy Hook incident, that to me was the moment where I knew that it was significant to say something about this issue. An unacceptable level of deceit. And I can feel it. And I can see the untruth in it. Don't let the corporate media tell you what to think and feel about this. Or Sandy Hook, or anything else. You might think you know what this is. Your principles fire up, and the old wiring fires up. And you know what you think, but do you? Or might it be an opportunity to upgrade that, to revise it, to re-evaluate it? I have to continually re-evaluate what my position is on any particular subject from moment to moment. Of course I do. Of course we all do. I think it's a healthy, wise, sane thing for a human being to do. Don't stick to your guns, if you pardon the pun. Know what is right from moment to moment, and if it persists as the same answer, then it has veracity. It has credibility. Now, if you can't be bothered to find out what you feel yourself and think yourself, which sounds a funny thing to say, but I think you know what I mean. If you see other people who can't be bothered to do it, which is probably more pertinent to those who listen to this, you see that people can readily pick opinions off the media rack in the mental fitting rooms of CNN and BBC and MSNBC and Reuters and all the rest of it. I can do that if I want to, but if I do, I'm not thinking or living authentically. I'm living in a state of psychic disavowal, and I have no right to challenge anyone else's view because I have not yet established my own. I am lying to myself and wasting the time of others. Shouting on the beach with you, Kramer. We have to take special control of ourselves. Wherever the corporate media asks us to saturate ourselves in pain, we bring our reason, our true emotional equipment, our intuition, and our gnosis right to that question, right to that viewpoint. These things all have equal value and must be balanced. If one dominates another, if your emotions take over, or even if your mental faculties take over, if your intuition is gone, or if you are only moving intuitively, wherever there is any imbalance, then we lose focus. We lose the signal of reality. There's a very obvious fact that many people continue to ignore with this question of guns and violence and whatnot. Controlling guns does nothing to address the disturbed and violent minds that make up a community, a population, or a whole people. Let's consider violence in Britain for a moment, a country that has no guns. A country whose government have decided that its general population is not allowed to legally own firearms. It has been decreed that the English, the Scottish, the Irish, and the Welsh are not to be trusted with guns. They are not to be trusted. It is better that only government and military agencies have them. And what is the result of this drastic disarmament? What is the result of this? Britain's violent crime record is worse than any other country in the European Union. Official crime figures show the UK has a worse rate for violence than the US and even South Africa. But when you look at statistics, you have to be careful about what that means. Overall crime and total crime numbers, rates per 100,000 people, etc. In terms of, as one newspaper put it, the League of Shame, which is always a bit of a dubious title, but we get what they're saying. Per 100,000 residents, the UK is at the top of the list. And then, surprisingly, Austria, South Africa, Sweden, Belgium, Canada, Finland, Netherlands, Luxembourg, France. Where's America on that list? Where is the USA? It's not on that top 10 list. And what about homicide rates? What has disarmament done for that? Well, for Britain, Britain has a higher homicide rate than most of its Western European neighbours, including France, Germany, Italy and Spain. It has the highest absolute number of burglaries in the European Union. If you travel to lovely little, farty, cute, rural Britain, as it's often seen from an American point of view, you'll probably encounter crime if you go long enough. More so than most other places. Gun control does nothing to change the fact that disturbed minds commit crime. I like this old TV show from the 1970s called The Sweeney, right? With John Thor as Regan and Dennis Waterman as Carter. And it's a cop show, but it's very gritty and it's very realistic. No holds barred, raw stuff. And it was groundbreaking at the time. And it's just a cop show that I enjoy watching from time to time. But one funny thing I learned is that the Sweeney,
is slang for the Sweeney Todd, which is a special police unit actually called the Flying Squad. You know these London Cockney types, they like to rhyme things. Apples and pears, stairs, boat race, face, all these funny odd rhymes they have. So the Sweeney Todd is the Flying Squad. And one interesting note, and this is from the words of a officer, a real person involved with the Flying Squad. After the soldiers returned to Britain from the war, the First World War in 1918, they were promised peace, prosperity and abundance. But when countless thousands of these people returned home, the exact reverse situation was true for most of the inner city areas and suburban areas. Levels of violence went through the roof. And you can draw whatever conclusions you want from that, but that is a reality. Levels of violence after the First World War went through the roof. They were overwhelming. It was at that time that the roots of the police service known as the Flying Squad were formed. The Flying Squad essentially was a kind of hard-assed police unit. It would cross any districts and boundaries and pursue villains wherever possible. They weren't stuck to their own precinct or boundaries. They could go anywhere and do anything, follow the case wherever the case took them. They were mobile. And so even considering this, the reality of what that does to people, how that changes people, and how that affects minds, that is the question here. The disturbance of one's conscious equilibrium, how that is affected by these matters. And in talking about disturbed minds, I had a point that I was going to raise with Brooks, but I didn't kind of get around to it. So I'll ask this as a question to the listener. Who is more disturbed? You have three choices. Number one, a young man who walks into a Connecticut school and shoots children and teachers. Number two, a military-trained special ops agent who goes into a Connecticut school and shoots children and teachers, and a patsy geek kid. Or number three, a young man who sits in an air-conditioned room in Nevada and remotely controls a drone that kills women, children, elders, and innocent bystanders, as well as so-called insurgents, who also does this on a regular basis, gets a paycheck, and the personal backing of President Obama. Who is the more disturbed of those three? Are they enormously different kinds of disturbances, or are they very similar? Are they, in fact, all part of the same disturbance, all the same one thing? Let us see the truth here. This has nothing to do with guns. We have to have the courage to face this and say what it is. We can then talk about solutions. We can then talk about ways out of this mess. And we can look at things we can actually do to improve it. Not just constantly examine the problem, but actually create answers. Before you can do that, you have to examine the issue in its unadorned, truthful state. We cannot transcend the illusory nature of reality until we fully articulate it. This is the same for everything. We cannot move beyond self until we have fully attained selfhood. The abstract expressionist artist cannot paint beautifully and authentically until they have mastered the basics of realism, of painting a realistic scene, landscape, nude, still life, or whatever. Only when they have fully understood the construction of reality as it is, good and bad, warts and all, beauty and ugliness, cracks and deceptions, only then can they begin to deconstruct it and rearrange it in their own way, to repaint it in accordance with a more authentic and elegant will, a more divine pattern. Observing reality is exactly like this. We cannot move beyond the illusion until we face it, breathe it, know it. Then, and only then, can we transcend this forgery and move into the real thing, to let the sun shine on our faces for the first time. You know, it would certainly be a lot easier for me to just not talk about these sort of things. But you know what? That would be the height of weak, inauthentic behaviour on my part. So I refuse to give in to the easy way out. I feel in my heart that this is something important that requires energy. And I, for one, willingly give my energy to this. Fortunately, even the issue of the Constitution and the Second Amendment won't always be with us We won't need to worry about protecting those things because they won't be there. There'll be something else that supersedes it. As we evolve, these instruments of law and contract and agreement become unnecessary. When you get with a bunch of conscious people, one notices there's very little need for any talk of morals or principles or ethics, because it's taken as read that those things were done and understood a long time ago. They don't need to be pored over and articulated and refined. They can kind of be done away with, because we know that now. It's right inside us. Sometimes things have to be destroyed so something new can be created. But it is weird when things go away, when things disappear. Though we do get used to the little disappearances in life. We're not fazed when a second ticks away into nothingness, or when the song on the radio finishes, or when our spouse leaves for work, or when the sun goes down. We realise that these things are part of a larger cycle and quite normal. We all understand that across the board, everything, one day, will no longer be. Moments, years, lifetimes, epochs, universes. They show up, do their thing, and then go away. Even so, permanent departures are a very curious business. In mainstream thinking, you know, dwelling on such things is positively discouraged. It might even be thought of as morbid. Yet, when we behold a gorgeous oak tree, is our appreciation of its form in any way diminished by our foreknowledge of its impending non-existence? No. The opposite is true. Our perception of its beauty and our appreciation of its presence are heightened. The wise man recognizes the truth that it is purely a transient mirage, and what is being witnessed is really a process. Not a separate or discrete thing, though in this zone of dense temporal flow, where everything's so dramatically slowed down so we can understand it, we often forget that. Now, a little while ago, I was writing in a coffee shop in Portland. There are hundreds of these things in Portland, all over the place. Some of them are most excellent, as it happens. Anyway, a few tables over, there was this old lady with advanced dementia, apparently out for a treat with her carer. And, you know, the old lady could not remember who anyone was, what town she lived in, where she was at that moment, or where she was going later in that day. And her voice was tremulous, and her body was frail. She repeatedly searched for her purse, despite the fact that each time she did so, she was gently reminded that it was safe at home. And her communication abilities and her knowledge base were really like those of a 7-year-old. And though all the other customers were very outwardly absorbed in their computers and books, really, they were all very carefully observing that very poignant and sobering scene. And it is sad to see somebody's mental faculties recede day by day. There's no doubt about that. Especially if it's your mother or your father or your sister or your brother. Or your wife. Or your husband. And yet, from another perspective, one could say that her mind is simply returning to the same state from which it came. A state that we know nothing about and has no physically evident relationship to our accustomed third density world. And now, as her journey nears completion, her presence in this form is no longer necessary. She is going away. And this points to the very heart of the matter. We are only afraid of things going away when we do not know what their new form will be. When the leaves fall from a tree, we're not bothered because we know they'll be back again soon in much the same form. When we get rid of our old laptop, our old antiquated computer, we don't worry about losing the hardware itself because we know we can repeat the same sort of experience on another platform again in much the same way. We can envisage what the new form will be, more or less. But when a big thing moves towards its end, like a person, or a way of life, or even a whole culture, we feel uneasy. Now, even the most rudimentary science tells us that energy is never destroyed, just changes form. And this is an important observation that serves both the engineer and the philosopher well. There is no going away, only transmutation. That is the truth of the thing. It only starts to feel weird when we move up the scale from simple systems to complex systems, and especially with the part of the process we call death. Mosquito dying, no big deal. Pet dog dying, big deal. Grandmother dying, huge deal. But let's take this a step further. What happens if we turn the dial right up? What is the most prodigious, ultra-destructive cataclysm we can conceive of? Well, how about this? The entire galaxy being consumed by a supermassive black hole. Everyone and everything, everywhere, sucked into the oblivion of the unknown. No more world, no more anything, ever. Current astronomical wisdom posits that most, if not all, galaxies actually do contain supermassive black holes at their centers. So maybe it really is the fate of all galaxies to eventually go down the drain. Trillions upon trillions of galaxies in the universe, all going down the plug hole until nothing is left. Wow. Sounds like a big deal. But will you not concede that the impact of a pet dog permanently disappearing, should we say, is somehow as significant as the end of the whole universe? Maybe even more so. There is a curious lack of meaning at the macro level, at the top end of the macro level. It's hard to relate to. But this hasn't stopped millions of people worrying unduly about prognostications of doom. As you may have noticed, the 13th Mayan Bacton ended on 21st of December 2012, or thereabouts. Now, some think a little sooner, some a little later, but you get the idea. And popular culture tells us that the end of this calendar cycle, along with a load of other similarly timed prophecies, may be equated with the end of the world. And that's a peculiar idea, I think. One that many Mayan elders who know what they're talking about also find peculiar. Most wise indigenous wisdom traditions don't see endings in quite the same way that Westerners do. Cycles end and then new ones begin. Get over it. It happens. And some more contemporary interpretations of these calendar dynamics equate the cycles with other kinds of progressive phases like states of consciousness, modes of behavior, stages of awakening. At root, every system big or small, is always trying to grow and refine. If it isn't achieving that, it necessarily collapses so it can reform into something new. This is true even with complex systems like cultural trends. But we often miss that, we often forget that, sometimes for very good reason. After the devastating physical and mental damage of World War II, a social conditioning instruction of passivity was very easy to install into billions of war-weary citizens of both Allied and Axis powers, as it were, spread throughout the world. Entire populations just automatically did what the hell they were told, having no reason, no energy to argue with anything that the government decreed. The Allied nations had faith, naturally, at that time, in their statesmen, their military, and their lawmakers. Sure, there were a few revolts and objections here and there, but all the nice, well-dressed, lovely, quiet people just read about it or watched it on a screen. And this conditioning worked right up until the 1960s, when people started to question the very essence of it. And even though large swathes of apparently spontaneous 60s culture were actually meticulously planned think tank social strategies, there's always some organic breakthrough. There's always something that strikes a note of truth amid any dissonance that exists at that time. And it was a small percentage, but hugely powerful. Then in the 1970s, there was a re-establishing of faith in the social order by economic force. A stark option was put before the people. What do you want? The poverty of socialism or the affluence of capitalism? Lack or abundance? And this played out in endless fabricated corporate union battles and struggles for private-public ownership. In the end, people voted for a perceived sense of prosperity, which meant Thatcher from 79 to 1990 and Reagan from 1981 to 1989 came into power. That was the new Western template. This spiritually crippling proposed way of living took a couple of decades to unhook itself from social consciousness. And admittedly, it was an enormously convenient concept, with a nice good and evil world based on hierarchies of commercial function. But its wrongness was titanic. Whilst it claimed to promote self-reliance and personal economic mobility, the real goal was to pit man against man. To be successful within that paradigm, one had to live as inauthentically as possible. The scale of self-deceit was epic. Eventually, however, of course, people finally realized that the whole concept was untrue, and so it collapsed. And only the most hardened conservatives continue to cling to those ridiculous tenets. Anything that focuses on material or mental competitiveness blocks conscious growth. So here's an idea. Some people cannot live without the spectre of an opposing force in their lives, whether real or imaginary. Other people cannot live without the promise of something wonderfully escapist in the near future, real or imaginary. Both of these are mental strategies that happily displace the mind from its immediate present moment imbalance and boot it into an alternative projected scenario, good or bad. At work here is the old self-created adversary of disavowal. Something inside, too hard to deal with, is thrown into the outside world and is made into a living
melodrama. So world-changing scenarios, apocalypses, a perfect fodder for this fugue state. The more a person pours their consciousness into an external contrived reality, the longer they can defer their own inner purification. Takes the pain away of the inauthenticity when we join someone else in their fantastic reality tunnel. And these, what I call Kmart prophets, keep getting away with it. Easy when you know how. So when big prophecy days regarding all manner of phenomena come and go, without particular note, three common techniques are employed to address the discrepancy. And you can see this play out. Number one, it did happen, the big prophecy date, but in another dimension, in another timeline that is not easily perceived. Number two, it did not happen, thank goodness, because the future timeline was successfully changed by our light workers. Or number three, keep moving the date forward. So all these tried and tested methods can be seen spinning around and around, over and over, fooling lots of people. And honestly, my patience for this kind of thing, I think, has finally run out. The last grain of sand has fallen from the glass timer, right? I can let a lot of things go, but not this. The control system death spasms are only going to be prolonged by having our own spiritual kinsmen pissing their prophetic specialness up the wall. Not good enough. Not good enough. Real discipline is needed for real power. Without that discipline, there is no power. And there's a common sense angle to being prepared for interruptions to our normal routines. So though the big end of the world day has come and gone at the time of this recording, there are mini apocalypses all the time. Anyone who has ever lived through a great social depression or a war or rationing of everyday resources or earth changes knows perfectly well that having some additional basic supplies stored close at hand is a very wise move. Simple things like that. It means that you won't be one of the chumps standing in line at Walmart supercentres or government distribution camps or FEMA handout stations or whatever in the event of some huge social disruption. No, you'll be able to choose to wait it out or move out or do whatever you want to do. The unprepared will not have the luxury of that selection. And I've experienced three of my own mini apocalypses here in the USA, each of increasing severity. First, a blizzard and whiteout in Nebraska. Then an ice storm in the mountains of Washington State. And finally, a hurricane in New York, which you may have heard of. Safety, well-being, and essential supplies and resources and normal things of day-to-day living were all at risk, sometimes not even there. Everyone lived to tell the tale. It was with me. But it was a taste of what can happen when the normal patterns of human operation are suspended. Things change fast, really fast. As an animal, it's wise to be able to move as the world moves. Don't lumber yourself with concrete shoes. And particularly with Hurricane Sandy in New York, it was most eerie to see the little district where I used to live in Queens ravaged. It's still not back to normal. My old apartment there was completely submerged in icy black water. People in that neighborhood died. Businesses were permanently ruined. Houses were washed away, literally washed away, gone. I've only ever seen that on TV before, but now I've seen it with my own eyes.
And our friend Obama showed up and just handed out sort of meaningless platitudes as it happened, saying things like, people still need emergency help. They still need heat. They still need power. They still need shelter. Kids are trying to figure out where they're going back to school. And then he left. That was it. It didn't feel like he cared at all. When you're in the midst of something like that, you can feel people who mean it and people who don't more than normal. Whereas Chris Christie, who to me looks like an extra from The Sopranos or something, the governor of severely impacted New Jersey, fared a lot better. He really seemed to give a shit and actually got things done. Anyway, I digress. The point is that even with a weather-related event like this, natural or synthetic, over 8 million homes in one of the most modern cities in the world were left powerless, literally powerless. Millions of lives and livelihoods will take years to properly recover. And as we said before, a lot of the things that used to be in those neighborhoods have disappeared. People and things. These are real life mini apocalypses. They happen all the time. What's the difference between your house being crushed by a hurricane or a mothership from Arcturus 7 by accident when its light drive breaks down, right? Or by a meteorite, or by Satan, or by the four horsemen of the apocalypse? What's the big difference? There isn't any. So let's not generate drama unnecessarily. The world is already quite plump with drama. That's what life is. A drama. On a stage. A theatre. There are far too many for us to get our teeth into without us churning out a surfeit of new drama. Wrongness in either our perception of cataclysm or politics or society, or more significantly, our own inner development, is fundamentally a reflection of imbalance. Simple. A lack of harmony. It doesn't even mean, when you really come down to it, that it is something bad. Is destruction always, without exception, bad? Or can it sometimes be okay to have something taken down to make way for something new to be built? Viewed through this lens, we could say that all manifestation in life can be broken down into either appearing or disappearing, as we've said. Negatives are only felt as unpleasant polarizations when they lack balance, when the weight of consciousness leans too heavily in one direction or the other. Now, if you're an animal, flesh and blood and bone, which I presume you are, take that the right way, we all know that positives are more appealing than negatives. Abundance, people, love, food, warmth, sharing, excitement, fulfillment. They are more pleasurable. They sit more happily with us. They are more attractive than pain and sorrow, heartache, isolation, depression, right? And yet all of these things are polarizations, are they not? Hello. That was a dog that just licked my knee. Where was I? Yeah, they're all polarizations. The middle point is what we aim for. But you can only get to the middle point once you have understood both polarized extremes. And that usually means experiencing them. But if we exercise our capacity for insight and empathic psychic connection, we need not necessarily throw ourselves into the furnace in order to fully comprehend it. We don't have to experience it. We can just know it. We can know these things in other ways. by virtue of our intellect and our higher awareness, if we have chosen to activate those things. There is something indisputably that gives knowing, that lies outside the machinations of the blob of our brain. Big mind, outside us, a mind with which we can connect, a non-local knowingness, a cloud awareness, you might say these days, to which we always contribute and from which we may readily draw, a free library, not only of knowledge, but of experience. Everybody's experience is in there. You want to know what it's like to be a world-class freediver? Something that you've never done? Be it. Be it from that big mind. See what that brings. But whichever way you look at it, you cannot be a wise man if you do not know sorrow. You cannot be a wise man if you do not know joy. And in our hearts, we want joy. We want bliss. We want togetherness, we want peace. But that is the animal speaking, because those things are not credible destinations in themselves. They are things that accompany natural conscious evolution. They happen when we grow inside. We need not pursue them. In fact, the more we pursue them, the more they evade us. And even though this is the animal voice, we should honor it, because we are animals. That is a critical part of our experience as humans. But there is another component to human consciousness that transcends the purely physiological desires of the flesh. And this other component doesn't exist here purely as a product of the brain. It is somewhere else. And when we walk this path, this mystical path, we make this pilgrimage, we begin to make contact with that other component. We begin to foster a relationship with it. And when we do that, all the rules change. We have to become multidimensional, not as an objective, not as some fancy metaphysical attainment, but as a necessity, because we are multidimensional. We are many things in many places at the same time. This is a great secret of the human experience. It is something that elevates us above just being the flesh. Today has been a day of polarization for me. I have looked into the animal nature, the negative, the aggression, the pain of deceit, the injustice of devious manifestations. But I have drawn more knowing from it. I see a little deeper each time I look at these things. And an awesome point of balance has been afforded to me consciously through the choice of where I have chosen to think, feel, and express these things, which is here. Where the ocean meets the land. There is not one thing or another where I am now. It isn't quite the ocean, and it isn't quite the land. It's something between the two. It's like the solstice time. Two systems move closely together. They intermingle. The boundaries of each overlap and fuse together. And if one can move lucidly into that melange, it is possible to see with a great clarity. Certain things can be laid to rest. Unhelpful energies can be safely discharged here. Supportive energies can be amplified. So it's good for us to seek out these places, to know where they are. keep a personal chronicle of where they are in your land. The forests, the beaches, the lakes, the meadows. Sometimes parks, city streets and special buildings even. Sometimes those. But more often than not, these places, these sacred places, are in the natural environment, where the human footprint is light, or even completely absent. In about an hour from now, the sun will fall behind the ocean. And darkness will come here. And I will have to create my own light if I wish to see here. And that shows me precisely the way to do things. Without shadow, there is no world. Without light, there is no world. We navigate them, and we move between them with as much awareness and as much truthfulness as we can. And in that, we accrue wisdom. And we find evidence of the divine in everything, every grain of sand. We see what is real, every rock, every wave, every face. And we smash unreality without trying. It is neutralized as we begin to comprehend its purpose. Where there is balance, where there is the harmony of knowing, polarization recedes. We must know the extremes to know the center.